Here we are again for Find Your Purpose Now. You know, today I want to do something a little bit different with you. I was thinking about what it was like when I didn't know my purpose, and I was just beginning to kind of feel, to learn what I was really passionate about and what I really wanted to be doing with my time. And I realized that when I helped a certain demographic, for me, it was homes for abused children. But when I realized that when I was doing what I was supposed to do, I got this really amazing feeling. I felt so good. I mean, I had never felt that kind of just excitement, just that good feeling that I knew that I knew that I knew that I'd done something good. And that it wasn't something that a lot of other people were able to do. I realized that it was kind of a unique thing, that there weren't very many people, actually, when I started my business, there was nobody else that I knew of that really did this work and they really wanted to be doing it, like they really understood it. There were people who, you know, kind of did it out of a sense of obligation, but they really weren't passionate and committed. So not trying to throw them under the bus, but just kind of explaining, trying to explain the difference. So whatever it is that you are passionate about, we've talked about passion being one of the clues, the things that you love doing. You just can't get enough of it. You can't wait to get there. You enjoy it while you're doing it. It's not a grind. It's not something that you can't stand. So if you've thought about your passion and your, you know, you kind of have an idea about it. I was thinking, you know, I would like to help you to like lean into it, figure out how to do it, like how to make a living at it, or at least how to start to get involved in it, even if at first you can't make money at it. Maybe it's a hobby. You know, I don't know what you're passionate about, and whether or not it's something that, you know, you're ready to just dive into full time. I know for me, when I dove in, when I figured it out and I dove in, I quit my job, you know, the one that had the paycheck and the health insurance and the benefits. And I started my own business where I didn't have all of those supports and I didn't have family and I didn't have money. I didn't have a safety net at all. Not sure that I would really recommend that to somebody at this point. Unless the caveat to that is, you've really prayed about it. You're really, really sure that that's the direction that God's leading you to go. And that's how I felt. I was 100% sure that I was supposed to move forward with doing this work. And I threw myself into it with reckless abandon. So whether or not that is your mindset at this point, or wherever you happen to be on the continuum, I wanted to just talk to you about the first step. Okay. The first step is to start really getting a clear picture in your mind of what it would look like for you to do what you want to do, what you feel called to do every day, or at least some aspect of it every day. Like, what would it really look like? Yeah, I'm telling you to daydream. Think about it. Really imagine it in your mind. What would it be like? What would it feel like to go do that every day? What would you feel like after a long day of that? Would you feel exhausted but exhilarated? Would you feel like, I don't know. I don't know if I really want to do that. Because this is a way, using your imagination, it's a way that you can kind of take a step toward really thinking about what your day will be like, what your average day would be like if you threw yourself into your purpose with reckless abandon. That's the first thing. The second thing is to be able to talk about it. Now, before you run and start telling everybody in your life, hey, this is what I want to do. I think I know what I want to do. I'm really excited about it. Get a clear message put together for how you talk about it. Now, that might sound you know, not even doable to you. But you can do this. And what I want you to do is really work on it. So once you get it in your mind about what that looks like, what you'll be doing, what your day would be like, who are you helping? How does it feel when you help them? What are you doing specifically? When you have that picture, then you can put words to it. So think about how you talk about it. Because I was trying to think about, okay, what did I do? I prayed about it. I got a clear vision of what I wanted to do. Like, I wanted to recreate that amazing feeling of helping, at that time, we called them homes for abused children. And I just wanted that feeling every day. That feeling was amazing. I wanted to recreate it. Maybe it's what people feel like who use drugs. Like, you want that high again. I wanted that feeling again. And I wanted to create a life where that was a normal thing, not a once every who knows how long apart thing. So once I had it in my mind of what it would look like, it would mean me starting my own business. Oh, what did that look like? What would I need to do that? What didn't I have that I needed? So that's part of that thinking process and getting that really clear in your mind. But once I had that, then I started talking about it. And it's kind of amazing what happens when you start really verbalizing what you want, what you really want, what you're really clear on. I mentioned it to a client who was a friend and mentor. And actually, it was something that he had said kind of casually, like, oh, well, you know, if the insurance agency work for doesn't want you to insure homes for abused children, why don't you start your own insurance agency? And I was like, oh, why didn't I think of that? So he was the first person that I went and spoke to about it and said, you know, I think this is what I want to do. And the conversation was really around, okay, so what do you think you have to do first? And what do you need? So other conversations were, you know, maybe not quite so encouraging. There were some people who didn't think it was a great idea, but it wasn't the assignment that God had given them. So I listened, you know, and I took it in because I wanted to have an eyes wide open idea of what it would really mean. And I'm saying that to you because, you know, don't listen to this podcast and call your boss and quit your job. You have to plan. You have to get your ducks in a row. You have to really think through what everything will look like and what it will take. And then really whether or not you're willing to pay the price in terms of work, the hard work, the hours that'll go into it. Maybe there's an investment of money that has to be made into it. Maybe that means finding a small business administration loan, or maybe that means, you know, a bank loan, or maybe that means, like in my case, I sold my house. I sold my furniture. I sold my wonderful, super nice car that I thought I thought it was my wonderful, super nice car. And I downsized on that. I just downsized on everything in order to make my dream come true, basically. So you have to really think about, are you willing to pay the price? And as you start talking about it with your friends, with your family, you want to be careful about coworkers and people like that if you're not ready to quit your job. But the more you talk about it, the more it will become real in your mind. And, you know, you may hear some great advice from people who become mentors to you. You may get great guidance. You may hear some criticism. You may hear about, well, you really don't know how to do this, so you need to be careful about that. Like for me, it was my boss when I went and gave notice who said, well, you don't know what you don't know. There's a lot you don't know. And you don't know how to keep the books for an insurance agency. And you don't know how to get company appointments for an insurance agency. And you don't know how to do this. You don't know how to do this. And it was a very long list of all the things I didn't know how to do. And every single thing he said was correct. He didn't dissuade me, though. So you have to be careful not to get offended if somebody speaks the truth to you. You want to give people permission to tell you the truth. Now, I'm not sure what his motivation was. Maybe he was trying to dissuade me. I don't know. I mean, he said the way it ended was him saying, okay, well, when you fall flat on your face, we might have a job here for you. You know, you could call me. And I thought, oh my, well, I didn't say this, but I thought it. I will dig ditches in the hot sun and wash dishes and whatever it is that I have to do before I'll come crawling back for this job. But the words that came out of my mouth were, okay, thank you so much for your time. And thank you for everything that I've learned here. And I've learned so much and I'm grateful. That's what I said. So when somebody tells you what you don't know, here's what I want you to do. Instead of getting offended or hurt, think of it as awesome advice. Somebody who sees something about you that maybe you don't know about yourself. Well, I knew that I wasn't a good bookkeeper. I knew that I didn't have the character traits to be a bookkeeper, but it was really helpful for me to hear the advice about the things that I needed to learn. I really did need to learn about those things. So pay attention to that stuff. The things that you don't know how to do, you either need to learn how to do, or you find a partner or employee who knows how to do those things and let that person just be in their lane and flow and fulfill their purpose of doing those things that don't come easily to you. But I do want you to think about verbalizing. So go back to the message. Once you're clear in your mind about at least the passion part, the thing that makes you feel good, you might not have an idea yet of how to turn it into a business or how to make a living doing it, or you know whether or not it's even feasible. Maybe it's a hobby. And it's really not going to be a business at any point. Or maybe it's going to be a nonprofit organization. Even if you're not clear on all that stuff, begin to verbalize what you are clear about. Like, for me, it was, I feel so amazing when I'm able to help people and organizations that take care of children who have been abused. It's a feeling that I can't even really describe. That's what I was able to say. See, it's not a business plan, but that's what I was able to say. Whatever it is that you can say and start saying about it, get it to the point where you can say it in a minute. That's probably... what do they say? I think it's 150 words or whatever that the average person can speak 150 words in a minute. I think that's what it is now. So write it down if that helps you, and write it and edit it and write it and say it out loud and say it in the mirror and say it to your best friend, and it'll change, and you'll edit it and you'll adapt it until it really speaks of the thing that's in your heart and the vision that's in your head. And as you continue to talk about it with people and think about it, and gosh, the most important thing, pray about it and ask God to give you a clear vision of His plans for your life, you'll build on it and build on it and build on it. One step, one block at a time, until you'll find yourself living it. I hope that you do it, and I hope that you let me know about it. I want to know what you're thinking. I want to know when you find that thing that makes you feel really good. Some of the stories that I've heard through the years are just really, truly remarkable. People who have chosen to do hospice work, for example. One of my friends told me about just how she felt that it was so incredibly rewarding to her to work with people who are in the last moments of their lives. Wow. I have another friend who is such a gifted teacher, such an educator. And she told me she literally just loves her students. And she wants the best for them. And she wants to equip them and teach them what they need to know so that they have the foundation that they can build on for a really good life, for a purposeful and meaningful life. And I said, what's your advice to a young teacher or somebody who wants to be a teacher? And I thought it was so interesting that she said, please, please, please don't do it unless you love the young people in your influence. There's passion there. So whatever it is for you, make sure that you're passionate about it, that you really want to move forward with it. If you haven't found that thing, just keep trying everything that comes your way. Keep praying for God to reveal it to you, for him to open doors for you to just walk right into it or stumble into it or fall into it, as was my case, falling into the insurance industry. Whatever it is, take those chances, take those steps, because in doing something new, you may just find out that you just love it. And that's when the trajectory of your life changes and you think you're going this way and you just veer off and it's like, wow, okay, I got it. This is great. That's what I want to do. That's what I love doing. And when you're living that life where you love what you do, you feel good about it every day. You feel good about yourself. Your self-esteem improves because you know you're doing something good and valuable and worthy and honorable in the world. You're doing things that help people and organizations and the people that they serve. It's a beautiful thing when we can see ourselves as a part of the whole, a part of whatever it is that gives us meaning and value. I fully believe that the secret to a good life is purpose and meaning and connection. And when we're living our purpose, we feel joy and peace. We have healthy relationships with the people around us because we're not stressed all the time. And when you're joyful and peaceful, you just attract other joyful and peaceful people. It's not, some weird thing. It's just a practical matter. Like, who do you want to hang out with? You want to hang out with somebody who's, you know, happy and positive and optimistic, and you get all that when you're living your purpose and you know your meaning and you have healthy connection. And with all of that comes enough financial provision to be able to do what you were made to do. Okay, I hope this is helpful. I hope I didn't ramble too much. I'd love to hear from you. Please subscribe and please share this with anybody who you think could use it. These are the people who are sad and unhappy and depressed, miserable, grouchy, irritable, all of those kinds of adjectives. Those are the signs that people are not in their purpose. And altogether, we can help ourselves and we can help others to find and live in the sweet spot of our purpose. So that's it for today. There's a link if you'd like to get in touch with me. I'd love to hear from you. It's in the description. And I'll see you next week.